So, good afternoon, dear students. I have completed certain topics like slope stability, foundation engineering, in which I have discussed about the bearing capacity of the soil, and I have also discussed vertical stresses topic, and I have discussed how types of settlement, their importance and concept of settlement, in which I have discussed about the total settlement, total uniform settlement and differential settlement. Afterwards, I have also discussed in some videos to tabulate the immediate settlement and consolidation settlement. I have given several numerical problems to solve on bearing capacity from BC Punamiya, several solved problem which have previously came in competitive examinations, and also I have given previous gate year question paper to solve from slope stability topic and vertical bearing capacity of the soil. In the next week I will give the topic related to the vertical stresses and settlements of foundation, which have previously came in some competitive examination. I have given the questions from vertical stresses. After that, I will discuss the I will try to revise the topic of consolidation and vertical stresses once again. Today I will discuss the factors affecting the bearing capacity of the soil. Yesterday I have discussed about the factors affecting the choice of foundation, their depth of foundation, and now I will discuss the factors affecting the bearing capacity of the soil. And in this while discussing this topic, I would revise some concept of bearing capacity of the soil also. Afterwards, once I will complete, so the only thing which will be left in this third unit will be tolerable limit and BIS, Bureau of Indian Standard specification for the settlement limits for rafts and shallow foundation. These things are very easy to understand, and proportioning part I will discuss some meanwhile. So once I will revise the topic of vertical stresses and consolidation, I will also take 1 or 2 days to revise the topic of slope stability. Those students who have not understand the concept of slope stability will certainly try to recall the concept of slope stability and all those things. So students, keep solving the numerical problems, keep brushing up your concepts while going through the videos, go through the laboratory experiment which I have shared in the Moodle, go through some books like BC Punamiya, VNS Murthy, Sashige Gulati and Datta for theory portion, and for numerical portion you can prefer C. Venkatramaiya, some reference book like Joseph E. Bowles and Brajam Das can be also followed for theory and numerical process for getting more and more practical knowledge about the subject. Once you are brushing up your basic concept of this subject, you should try to learn the basic field application of this subject. Also go through some NPTEL videos and MIT open course videos, which I have told you all people in the introductory session in the beginning only. So try to go through those videos also. Try to go through virtual labs for laboratory purpose. Go through the profiles of professors in IITs and foreign universities to get the in-depth knowledge of the subject, and try to learn what extra you can do in these geotechnical engineering 1 and 2. So, and also if you are getting time, try to solve the numerical problem of the previously have come in the competitive examinations like GATE and engineering services, and for the UKPSC A exam and Staff Service Commission junior engineer examination, you should revise these topics, because geotechnical engineering 1 and 2 carries much weightage in these competitive examination. So try to solve the numerical problem and try to brush up your concept on a regular basis of this subject. So friends, today I am starting a factor of affecting the bearing capacity, and I will revise the concept of bearing capacity also. So the subject of bearing capacity is perhaps the most important of all aspect of the geotechnical engineering. Loads from the building are transmitted to the foundation by column, by load bearing walls, or by such other load bearing component of the structure. Sometimes the material on which the foundation rests is ledge very hard or bedrock, which is known to be the much stronger than necessary to transport the load from the structure. Such a ledge or a rock or other stiff material may not be available at the reasonable depth, and it becomes invariably necessary to allow the structure to bear directly on soil, which will furnish a satisfactory foundation if the bearing member are properly designed. It is here that the subject of bearing capacity assumes significance. Such a ledge, some basic definition: foundation, the lowest part of a structure which is in contact with the soil and transmit load to it. Foundation soil or bed, the soil or bed to which the loads are transmitted from the base of the structure. Footing is a foundation consisting of a small slab for transmitting the structural load to the underlying soil. Footings can be individual slabs supporting the single column or combined to support two or more columns, or be a long strip of the concrete slab with B to the length capital L, ratio is small, that is it approaches to zero, supporting a load bearing wall or a mat. Bearing capacity is small q, the load carrying capacity of the foundation or soil or rock which enables it to bear and transmit load from the structure. Ultimate bearing capacity, q ultimate, maximum pressure which a foundation can withstand without the occurrence of a shear failure of the foundation. Gross or ultimate bearing capacity, the bearing capacity inclusive of pressure exerted by the weight of the soil standing on the foundation, or the surcharge pressure as it is sometimes called. Net bearing capacity QNU, gross bearing capacity minus the original overburden pressure or surcharge pressure at the foundation level. Obviously, this will be the same as that the gross capacity when the depth of the foundation is zero, that is the structure founded safe bearing capacity QS, ultimate bearing capacity divided by the factor of safety. The factor of safety in the foundation may ranges from 2 to 5. The factor of safety should be applied to the net ultimate bearing capacity. The surcharge pressure due to the depth of the foundation should then be added to the safe bearing capacity. It is thus the maximum intensity of the loading which can be transmitted to the soil without the risk of shear failure irrespective of the settlement that may occur. Gross safe bearing capacity is the maximum gross intensity inclusive of the overburden pressure of loading at the base of the foundation that the soil can support before failing in shear. Net safe bearing capacity QNS, it is the maximum net intensity exclusive of the overburden pressure of the loading at the base of the foundation that the soil can support without the risk of the shear failure. Allowable bearing pressure QA, the maximum allowable net loading intensity on the soil at which the soil never fails in the shear and doesn't pose any excessive settlement, or can we say that settlements are under the permissible limits. Ultimate limit state defines a limiting stress or force that should not be exceeded by any conceivable or anticipated loading during the design life of a foundation or any geotechnical system. Serviceability limit state defines a limiting deformation or a settlement of a foundation which, if exceeded, will impair the function of the structure that it supports. As per IS 6403-1981, net loading intensity, the net loading intensity of the foundation is the gross intensity of the load minus the weight of the displaced soil above the foundation base. Ultimate bearing capacity, the intensity of the loading at the base of the foundation which would cause shear failure of the soil support. Safe bearing capacity, maximum intensity of the loading that foundation will safely carry without the risk of the shear failure of the soil irrespective of the settlement that may occur. And safe bearing pressure or net soil pressure, the intensity of the loading that will cause a permissible settlement or a specified settlement of the structure. Allowable bearing capacity, the net intensity of the loading which foundation will carry without undergoing settlement in excess of the permissible value for the structure under consideration but not exceeding the net safe bearing capacity. types of the failure in the soil. Experimental investigation have indicated that foundation on the dense sand with relative density greater than 70% fails suddenly with pronounced peak resistance when settlement reaches about 7% of the foundation width. The failure is accompanied by the appearance of the failure surfaces and by the considerable bulging of a sheared mass of a sand as shown in a figure. This type of failure is designated as general shear failure by Terzaghi in 1943. So this is the general shear failure criteria, and this is the load versus settlement curve in the case of general shear failure criteria. So foundation on the sand of relative density lying between 37% and 70% do not show a sudden failure as the settlement exceeds about 8% of the foundation width. Bulging of the sand strands at the surface at the settlement of about 15% of the foundation width. A visible boundary of a sheared zone at a surface appears. However, the peak of the base resistance may never be reached. This type of failure is termed to be the local shear failure. So you all people can see the load versus settlement curves for the local shear failure. Foundation on relatively loose sand with relative density less than 35% penetrate into the soil without any bulging of the sand surface. The base resistance actually increases as the settlement progresses. The rate of the settlement, however, increases and reach a maximum settlement of about 50 to 20% of the foundation width. Sudden jerks or shear can be observed as soon as the settlement reaches about 6 to 8% of the foundation width. The failure surface, which is vertical or slightly inclined and follows the parameter of the base, never reaches the sand surface. This type of failure is designated as a punching shear failure by Vesig in 1963. So this is the load versus settlement curve for punching shear failure. The approximate terms of types of failure to be affected as relative, the approximate limit of the types of failure to be affected as relative depth, DF, depth of foundation by width, and relative density of the sand, that is represented by DR as shown in a figure, Vesig 1963. General shear failure occur when the phi is more than or equal to 38 degree, and local shear failure when phi is greater than or equal to 28 degree. So in this graph you can see the mode of failure depending upon the relative density of the sand DR and relative depth of the foundation DF upon V. So with the help of this graph you can see whether the failure is general shear failure or local shear failure or punching shear failure. Criteria for the determination of bearing capacity, location and depth. A foundation must be properly located at and founded at such a depth that its performance does not affect by factor such as lateral expulsion of the soil from beneath the foundation, seasonal volume change and presence of adjoining structures, etc. Shear failure of a foundation or bearing capacity failure, as it is sometimes called, shall not occur. This is associated with the plastic flow of the soil material underneath the foundation and the lateral expulsion of the soil from the underneath the footing of the foundation. Number three, the probable settlement differential as well as total of the foundation must be limited to the safe, tolerable or acceptable magnitude. In other words, the anticipated settlement under the applied pressure on the foundation should not be detrimental to the stability of the structure. Last two criteria are known as the shear strength criteria and settlement criteria, respectively. The design value of the shear bearing capacity obviously would be smaller of the two values obtained from these two criteria. Factors affecting the bearing capacity, that is the nature of the soil and its physical and engineering properties, nature of the foundation and other details such as size, shape, depth below the ground surface and rigidity of the structure. Total and differential settlement that structure can withstand without the functional failure. Location of the groundwater table relative to the level of the foundation and initial stresses, if any. So methods of determining the bearing capacity tables in various building codes, analytical methods, plate bearing test, penetration test, model test and the prototype test and some laboratory test. Actually, I have discussed all these things, so I will revise all these things in a very quick manner. So analytical approach, the theory of elasticity by Sizzler's method, classical earth pressure theory by Rankine's method, Pockert's method, and Bell's method, the theory of plasticity by Fallacious method, Prandtl's method, and Terzaghi method, Mayerhoff's method, Skempton method, Brinch-Hansen method, and Ballas method, plate load test and penetration test. So this method, based on the Rankine's earth pressure theory, is too approximate and conservative for the practical use. You all people might have learned this theory, Rankine's earth pressure theory, at the time of earth pressure chapter. So Rankine uses the relationship between the principal stresses at the liquid limiting equilibrium condition of the soil element, one just beneath the footing and other just outside in the figure. In an element I just beneath the footing, at the base level of the foundation, the applied pressure Q ultimate is the major principal stress under its influence, and the soil adjacent to the element tends to get pushed, creative active action. The active pressure is the sigma on the vertical faces of the element. From the relationship between the principal stresses at the limiting equilibrium relating to the active stress, so we have sigma is equal to Q ultimate into K into A is equal to Q ultimate equal to 1 minus sin phi upon 1 plus sin phi. In element 2, just outside the, at the base, outside the footing, at the base level of the foundation, the tendency of the soil adjacent to the element is to compress, creating passive condition. The pressure sigma on the vertical faces of the element will thus be the passive resistance. This will thus be the major principal stress, and corresponding minor principal stress is Q is equal to gamma into df. So sigma is equal to Q dot Kp. Kp is the coefficient of passive earth pressure, is equal to gamma df into Kp. So this can be written as gamma df 1 plus sin phi upon 1 minus sin phi. From equation 1 and 2, we get Q ultimate is equal to gamma into df up into 1 plus sin phi upon 1 minus sin phi ka whole square. This gives the bearing capacity of the footing. It does not appear to take into the account the size of the footing. To give the depth of the foundation, which is termed to be the minimum that is required for a foundation. So df is equal to Q upon gamma 1 minus sin phi upon 1 plus sin phi ka whole square. It does not appear to take into account the size of the footing. An alternative approach based on the earth Rankine's earth pressure theory, which takes into the account the size small b of the footing, is as follows. It is assumed that the rupture in the soil takes place along, this rupture takes place along CBD. This is b by 2, Q is equal to gamma df surcharge, and so place along a rupture in the soil takes place along CBD and CFG symmetrically. The failure zone are the mode of the two wedges as shown. It is sufficient to consider the equilibrium of the one half. Wedge in the Rankine's active wedge. Wedge is a Rankine's active wedge and pushed downward by Q ultimate on CA. Consequently, the vertical phase AB will be pushed outward. Wedge 2 is the Rankine's passive wedge. The pressure capital P on the phase AB of the wedge 1 will be same as that of the which acts on phase AB of the wedge 2. Consequently, the soil wedge 2 is pushed up and the surcharge Q is equal to gamma df due to the depth of the footing resists this. So you can see in the diagram. So from wedge 2, AB bar is equal to B by 2 tan alpha, and is equal to B by 2 tan 45 plus 5 by 2 is equal to B by 2 under root n phi. So you all people might have gone through these terms in shear strength parameter chapter. So capital P is equal to half gamma B square upon 4 into n phi ka whole square plus gamma df plus B by 2 n phi ka 3 ki power 2. From Rankine's theory, for the case with surcharge from wedge 1, similarly P is equal to half gamma B square upon 4 plus Q ultimate B by 2 under root n phi into 1 upon n phi is equal to half gamma B square upon 4 plus Q ultimate into B by 2 into 1 upon under root n phi. Q ultimate is equal to half into gamma into B by 2 upon under root n phi ka whole square minus 1 plus gamma df into n phi ka whole square. So Q ultimate is equal to half gamma dot B n gamma plus gamma df n q ka whole square, and gamma is equal to half under root n phi ka whole square minus 1, n q is equal to n phi whole square. Both are known as the bearing capacity factors. And this is Prandtl's method. Prandtl's analyzed the plastic failure in the metals when punched by the hard metal Pancher, Prandtl's 1920. This pressure analysis has been adopted to the soil when loaded to the shear failure by a relatively reserved foundation. Prandtl, 1921. So, assumption in the Prandtl's theory is that soil is homogeneous, isotropic, and weightless. The Mohr Coulomb equation for the failure envelope is equal to T is equal to C plus sigma tan phi is valid for the soil. Wedges 1 and 2 act as a reserved body. The zone in the sector 2 deforms plastically. In the plastic zone, all radius vectors or a plane through capital A and capital B are the failure planes, and the curved boundary is a logarithmic spiral. Wedge 1 is elastically pushed down, tending to push zones push zones 3 upward and outward, which is resisted by the passive resistance of the soil in these zones. The stress in the elastic zones 1 is transmitted hydrostatically in all directions. So Q ultimate is equal to C cot phi n phi into e to power pi tan phi minus 1. This is the Prandtl's ultimate bearing capacity equation for a C phi soil. For purely cohesive soil, phi is equal to 0, Q ultimate is equal to pi by 2 plus C is equal to 5.14 C. Discussion on Prandtl's theory. Prandtl's theory is based on the assumed compound rupture surface consisting of an arc of logarithmic spiral and tangents to the spiral. It is developed for a smooth and long strip footing resting on the ground surface. Prandtl's compound rupture surface corresponds fairly with the mode of the failure along the curvilinear rupture surface observed from the experiment. Prandtl's expression as originally derived does not include the size of the footing. Terzaghi method is in fact an extension and improved modification of the Prandtl's theory. The soil is semi-infinite, homogeneous, isotropic, weightless, rigid plastic material. The embedded depth is not greater than width of the footing. DEF is less than equal to B capital B. General shear failures occurs and the base of the footing is rough. The soil above the footing base can be replaced by a surcharge stress. This is the effect which effect means the shearing resistance of the soil located above the base is neglected. The zone of the plastic equilibrium is C, D, E, F, G. C, D, E, F, G can be subdivided into 1A wedge-shaped zone located beneath the loaded strip, in which the major principal stresses are vertical. Second, two zones of the radial shear, BCD and ACG, emanating from the outer edges of the loaded strip with their boundaries making an angle 45 degree minus 5 by 2 and 5 with the horizontal. And third, two passive Rankine zone, AZF and BD, with their boundaries making angle 45 degree minus 5 by 2 with the horizontal. The adjacent 4CA act as on the face AZ and BC. AC and BC is given by CA is equal to B upon 2 cos phi dot C. Considering the unit length of the footing and equilibrium of the wedge ABC, the vertical component of all forces must sum up to 0. The weight of the soil in the wedge is given by W is equal to gamma B square tan phi over 4, sigma V is equal to 0. B into Q ultimate plus gamma B square tan phi upon 4 minus 2 pp minus BC tan phi is equal to 0. Q ultimate is equal to 2 pp upon B plus C tan phi minus gamma B tan phi upon 4. So for simpler case of DF is equal to 0 and C is equal to 0 and Q is equal to 0, that is if the base of the footing rests on the horizontal surface of the mass of cohesion of the soil, we have pp is equal to half gamma h square cos delta sin alpha into kp, and capital H is equal to b by 2 tan phi delta is equal to phi, kp is equal to kp gamma, alpha is equal to 180 minus phi, pp is equal to half gamma b square upon 4 tan phi upon cos square phi into kp gamma, where kp gamma is the coefficient of passive earth pressure. For C is equal to 0, alpha is equal to 180 degree minus phi, and delta is equal to phi. This it is the value for purely due to the weight of soil. Substituting equation इक्वेशन 15 एंड इक्वेशन 14 क्यू अल्टीमेट्स फॉर सी इज इक्वल टू 0 इज इक्वल टू 1 बाई 4 गामा बी टैन फाई के पी गामा अपॉन कॉस स्क्वायर फाई माइनस 1 क्यू अल्टीमेट सी इज इक्वल टू फॉर सी इज इक्वल टू 0 इसको हाफ गामा बी एन गामा एन गामा इज इक्वल टू हाफ टैन फाई के पी गामा अपॉन कॉस स्क्वायर फाई माइनस 1. सो द वैल्यू ऑफ के पी गामा इज ऑब्टेन बाय द मीन्स ऑफ अ स्पायरल और फ्रिक्शन सर्किल मैथड. एन गामा इज द is called the bearing capacity factor expressing the effect of the weight of the soil wedge ABC of a cohesionless soil. So for the calculation of bearing capacity of a cohesive soil, the computation of PP involves a considerable amount of labor. Terzaghi therefore advocated a simple approach which is based on the equation PPN H upon sin alpha CKPC plus QKPQ plus half gamma h square into kp gamma upon sin alpha, where p p n is equal to normal component of the passive earth pressure on a plane contact face with a height capital H, alpha is equal to slope angle of the contact face, and kp c dash kp q dash and kp gamma is equal to coefficient of coefficient whose values are independent of h and gamma in present case, and capital H is equal to b by 2 tan phi, alpha is equal to 180 degree minus phi, and del is equal to phi. Also the total passive earth pressure PP on the contact face is equal to PPN upon cos delta. PP is equal to PPN upon cos delta is equal to PPN upon cos phi is equal to b upon 2 cos square phi into CKPC plus QKPQ plus half gamma into B square upon 4 into tan phi upon cos square phi into KP gamma, where CKPC plus QKPQ is equal to PPN is the normal component of the passive earth pressure component, passive earth pressure comprehending the effect of the cohesion and surcharge. Combining this equation 14, we have Q ultimate is equal to C into KPC upon cos square phi plus tan phi plus Q KPQ cos square phi plus gamma B upon 4 tan phi KP gamma cos square phi minus 1. If the soil wedge ABC is assumed weightless, gamma is equal to 0, Prandtl 1920 equation 21 takes the form Q ultimate C plus Q ultimate Q is equal to C KPC upon cos square phi plus tan phi plus Q into KPQ upon cos square phi is equal to Q ultimate is equal to C and C plus Q and Q. The factor NC and NQ are the pure number whose values depend on the value of the phi in a Coulomb equation. On the other hand, if C is equal to 0 and Q is equal to 0, gamma being greater than 0, the bearing capacity is given by equation 17 and 18. So this is Q ultimate is equal to half gamma B and gamma is equal to 1 by 4 gamma B tan phi KP gamma upon cos square phi minus 1. So Q ultimate is equal to Q ultimate C plus Q ultimate Q plus Q ultimate R is equal to, if the value of C, DF and gamma are greater than 0, it is equal to C and C plus gamma DF and Q plus half gamma B and gamma. So student, this is the Terzaghi general bearing capacity formula, and you all people try to solve some numerical problems on this equation number 25, that is Q ultimate is equal to C and C plus gamma DF and Q plus gamma B and Q, where the coefficient NC, NQ and gamma are bearing capacity factors for shallow continuous footings. C is equal to cohesion, gamma is equal to bulk unit weight, DF is equal to depth of foundation, B is equal to width of footing. So just try to solve some numerical formula from this Terzaghi equation. The problem of NC and NQ have been rigorously solved by means of Aries stress function by Prandtl's in 1920 and Reisner's in 1925 for the condition gamma is equal to 0 and C is equal to cot phi A theta ka whole square upon 2 cos square 45 plus 5 by 2 minus 1, NQ is equal to A theta whole square 2 cos square 45 plus 5 by 2, A theta is equal to E to power 3 pi by 4 minus 5 by 2 where tan phi. So the value of NC and NQ depends only on the value of phi. Bearing capacity for a stiff footing with a rough base on the ground surface is given by Q ultimate is equal to 5.7 C for a stiff footing at the depth DF, where in a purely cohesive soil, it is given as Q ultimate is equal to 5.7 C plus gamma DF. Equation 23, along with the shear, along with the bearing capacity factor, NC, NQ, and gamma are valid for general shear failure criteria. For local shear failure, C dash is equal to 2 by 3 C and tan phi dash is equal to 2 by 3 tan phi. So this for local shear failure, the value of C dash changes into 2 by 3 and tan phi dash changes into 2 by 3 tan phi. So for local shear failure, these formula becomes 2 by 3 C and C dash plus gamma DF and Q dash plus half gamma B and gamma dash. So in this graph, this is Tezagi bearing capacity factors plotted in figure, value of NC and Q gamma on the x-axis and value of phi in degrees. So from these chart, you can also tabulate the value of NC and QN and gamma, and also of NC dash, NC dash, NQ dash and NQ dash gamma. Quick note, as a general guidance, if the shear failure occurs at less than 5% and if the density index is greater than 70%, general shear failure criteria may be assumed. If the strain at the failure is 10% to 20% and if the density index is less than 20%, local shear failure criteria may be assumed. And for intermediate situation, punching shear failure, linear interpolation of the factors may be employed. So this is the bearing capacity factor of the Terzaghi are tabulated in a following table. This is angle of shear 0, 5, 10, 15, 20 and NC, NQ and gamma values are being given. So once the problems, numerical problems are given to you all people, either that graph will be given to you all people to tabulate the value of NC, NQ and gamma, and or either this table is given. So students, try to just read the question very carefully, whether they are asking the case of general shear failure criteria or local shear failure criteria, and try to solve the question. So bearing capacity of shallow foundation for circular and square footing. Bearing capacity for circular footing has been proposed by Terzaghi as Q ultimate C is equal to 1.3 C and C plus gamma DF and Q plus 0.3 gamma D and gamma, where D is equal to diameter of the footing. The critical load for the footing is given by Q ultimate is equal to pi D square upon 4 into Q ultimate C. Similarly, the bearing capacity for square footing of the site B is Q ultimate is equal to 1.3 C and C plus gamma DF and Q plus 0.4 B gamma and gamma. The critical load for the footing is given by Q ultimate B square into Q ultimate. For continuous footing of with B, it is already seen that Q ultimate is equal to C and C plus gamma DF and Q plus 0.5 gamma B and gamma. Thus, the bearing capacity of a circular footing of diameter equal to the width of the continuous footing is 1.3 times that of the continuous footing, or at least nearly so if the footing are founded in a purely cohesive soil, phi is equal to 0. The bearing capacity of the square footing of the side equal to the width of the continuous fittings also bears a similar relationship to that of the continuous footing under the similar condition just cited. Further, the corresponding ratios are 0.6 and 0.8 in the case of the circular footing and the square footing respectively when the footings are founded in a purely cohesionless soil. Skempton method in 1951, he found that the factor NC is a function of the depth of the foundation and also of its shape. So the net ultimate bearing capacity is given by Q net ultimate is equal to C dot NC. Strip footing NC is equal to 5 into 1 plus 0.2 DF upon B, with a limiting value of NC of 7.5 for DF upon B is greater than 2.5. So for square and circular footing, NC is equal to 6 times 1 plus 0.2 times DF upon B, which is a limiting value of NC of 9 for DF upon B is greater than 2.5. B is the side of the square or diameter of the circular footing. For DF upon B less than 2.5, NC is equal to 5 into 1 plus 0.2 B upon L, 1 plus 0.2 DF upon B, NC is equal to 7.5, 1 plus 0.2 B by L, equation number. So B is equal to width of the rectangular footing and capital L is equal to length of the rectangular footing. For a surface footing of a square or circular shape on a purely cohesive soil, Q net ultimate is equal to 6C, equation number 44, as against 7.4C from the Terzaghi theory. It must be noted that the Terzaghi theory is limited to the shallow foundation, wherein DF upon B is less than equal to 1. Skempton equation do not suffer from such a limitation. For a surface footing of a square or a circular shape on a purely cohesive soil, Q net ultimate is equal to 6C, as against 7.4C from Terzaghi theory. It should be noted, it must be noted that Terzaghi theory is limited to the shallow foundation. Df upon B is less than equal to 1, but Skempton equation does not such, suffer from such a limitation. So now I will discuss the Brinch-Hansen method. Brinch-Hansen 1961. Propose the following semi-empirical equation for bearing capacity of a footing as a generalization of the Terzaghi equation. Q ultimate is equal to Q ultimate upon A, CNC, SC, DC, IC plus QNQ, SQ, DQ, IQ plus half gamma, BN gamma, S gamma and I and I gamma. Q ultimate is equal to vertical component of the total load. Capital A is equal to effective area and Q is equal to overburden pressure at the foundation level is equal to gamma DF and NQ is equal to N phi into e ki power pi tan e ki power pi tan phi, NC is equal to NQ minus 1 cot phi and gamma is equal to 1.8 NQ minus 1 tan phi, NQ is equal to tan square 45 degree plus phi by 2 with the usual notation. S is equal to shape factor, D is equal to depth factor and I is equal to inclination factor. Continuous with small b for this is Brinch-Hansen shape factors for continuous footing, for rectangular footing, for square and for circular footing. You can determine the value of SC, SQ and S gamma shape factor and depth factor DC, and for DQ also you can determine from these charts. DC, DQ and U gamma can be determined, and inclination factor can be also determined from these formulas. Limitation H is less than is equal to V N at delta plus CABL, H and B are the vertical component and horizontal component of delta is equal to angle of friction between the base of the footing and soil, CA is equal to adhesion between the footing and the soil, L is equal to length of the footing parallel to the capital H, and Brinch-Hansen inclination factor, revised value of inclination factor is equal to IC, IQ is equal to 1 minus capital H upon V plus A C cot phi, I gamma is equal to IQ ga whole square, IC is equal to IQ for phi is equal to 0, 0.5 plus 0.5 under root 1 minus H upon capital AC. This is the revised Balazs method. Balazs has proposed his theory for net bearing capacity of continuous footing in 1962. The theory appears to give the values which are in good agreement with the field test result for footing founded in cohesionless soil. The form of bearing capacity equation is same as that of the Terzaghi. Q ultimate is equal to C dot NC plus gamma DF NQ plus half gamma B N gamma. So, but the equation of bearing capacity factors are cumbersome to solve the aid of digital computer. Therefore, it is generally recommended that Balazs chart can be used for determining these factors. So, depending upon the value of phi, C upon B gamma, you can determine the value of Balazs chart parameter. So the limitation so for NC and Q and gamma, these depending upon the Balazs chart Balazs parameter bearing capacity factor, these limitations are that it should be used between when DF upon B is less than equal to 1.5 and that it is applicable to the continuous footings only. So from this chart you can determine the value of NC and Q and gamma depending upon the value of phi and Balazs factor. Meyerhof's method. The important difference between Terzaghi and Meyerhof's approaches is that the latter considered the shearing resistance of the soil above the base of the foundation while the former ignores it. Thus the Meyerhof's allows the failure zones to extend up to the ground surface. Meyerhof's in 1951. You can see the logarithmic spiral, elastic zone, radius shear zone and mixed zone. Zone 1 is ABC is elastic, zone 2 BCD is radial shear and zone 3 BDF is mixed shear, wherein NC and Q and gamma are the Meyerhof's bearing capacity factors which depends only on phi and also on the depth and shape of the foundation and reference of the base. Meyerhof's factor are most difficult to obtain Terzaghi and have been presented in the form of the chart by Meyerhof. For strip footing, NC is equal to 5.5, 1 plus 0.25 DF upon B with a limiting value of 8.25 for NC. For DB upon capital B is greater than 2.5. For square or circular footing, NC is equal to 6.2, 1 plus 0.2 DF upon capital B with a limiting value of 9 for NC. For DF upon B is greater than 2.5. if b is the side of the square or diameter of circular footing. Wezik 1973 confirmed that the basic nature of the failure surface is suggested by Terzaghi as incorrect. However, the angle which the inclined surface makes with the horizontal was found to be closer than 45 degree plus pi by 2 instead of phi. Thus, the value of bearing capacity factors for a given angle of shearing resistance changes if the above modification is incorporated. If the analysis are as under, nq is equal to e power pi tan phi tan square 45 plus pi by 2, and c is equal to nq minus 1 cot phi, and n gamma is equal to 2 nq plus 1 into tan phi. Q ultimate is equal to C NC SC DC IC plus Q NQ. Equation 51 was proposed by Prandtl 1921. Equation 52 was given by Prandtl 1924. Cacot and Kesner 1915 and Wezik 1973 gives the equation 53. And Q ultimate is equal to C NC NC SC DC IC Q NQ SQ EQ IQ half gamma BN gamma S gamma and I gamma for phi value. NC and Q and gamma can be tabulated, and for a strip footing, for rectangular footing, for circular and square fitting, SC, SQ, gamma can be tabulated by these formulas. Depth factor can be tabulated by this formula. Inclination factor can be determined by these formulas. IS code method, IS 6403, given in 1981. QNU is equal to CNC, SC, DC, IC plus QNQ minus 1 SQ, DQ, IQ plus 0.5 gamma, BN gamma, S gamma, D gamma, I gamma into W dash. If the water table is at or below the depth of DF plus B measured from the ground surface, W dash is equal to 1. If the table rises above the footing or above, W dash is equal to 0.5. If the water table lies in between the value, it is obtained by linear interpolation. The safe factors given by the Hansen, factor as given by physics are used. DC, these are the same formulas for as given in previous method. For cohesive soil, QN is equal to CNC, SC, DC, and IC. NC is equal to 5.14. So now I would like to discuss the effect of water table. Water is in soil is known to affect its unit weight and also the shear parameter C and phi. When the soil is submerged under the water, effective unit weight gamma dash is used to for the computation of the bearing capacity. Effective unit weight gamma dash is roughly half the saturated unit weight. Consequently, there will be about 50% reduction in the value of the corresponding terms in the bearing capacity formula. Q ultimate is equal to CNC gamma DF NQ plus half gamma BN gamma. If the water table is at the level of the base of the footing, gamma dash is to be reduced for gamma. In the third term, a reduction factor of 0.5 is to be applied to the third term. For any location of the water table intermediate between the base of the footing and depth equal to the width of the footing below its base, a suitable linear interpolation of the necessary reduction is suggested. If the water table is above the base of the footing, the reduction factor for the third term is obviously limited to maximum of the 0.5. The maximum reduction of 0.5 is indicated for the second term when the water table is at the ground level itself or above it. Since the gamma dash is to be used for gamma in the second term, while no reduction in the second term is required when the water table is at or below the base of the footing. In the case for purely cohesive soil, since phi is equal to 0 degree and q is equal to 1 and gamma is equal to 0, net ultimate bearing capacity is given by C dot NC, which is virtually unaffected by the water table if it is below the base of the footing. If the water table is at the ground level, only gross bearing capacity is reduced by 50% and the surcharge term gamma DF NQ is equal to 1, while the net value is again only C dot NC in case of purely cohesionless soil. Since C is equal to 0 and phi is greater than 0, NQ and gamma are significantly high. For location of the groundwater table with the depth of the width of the foundation below the base of the ground and level of the equation, for the ultimate bearing capacity may be modified as Q ultimate is equal to C dash NC plus gamma DF NQ RQ plus half into gamma B gamma N gamma R gamma. C dash is equal to effective cohesion, and C and Q gamma are the bearing capacity factors based on phi dash. R Q and R gamma are the reduction factor for the terms involving N C, N Q and O owing to the effect of water table. R Q and R gamma may be obtained from the following figure. In figure you can see the Z Q, Z gamma, D F, B, and Z Q is equal to 0 for R Q is equal to 0.5, Z Q is equal to D F R Q for is equal to 1, Z Q is equal to D F for R Q is equal to 1, Z Q gamma is equal to 0 for R gamma is equal to 0, Z gamma is equal to B for R gamma is equal to 1. So from this graph you can see reduction factor R Q and gamma for Z Q upon D F or Z gamma upon B. R Q and R gamma can be tabulated. R Q is equal to 0.5 times 1 plus Z Q upon D F, and R gamma is equal to 0.5 times 1 plus Z gamma upon B. For note, for Z Q greater than D F, the water table is below the base of the footing. R Q is limited to 1. For 0, Z Q is less than is equal to 0, greater than equal to 0 and less than is equal to D F, the water table is above the base of the footing. R gamma is limited to 0.5. If ZQ is greater than DF plus B or greater than Z gamma is greater than B, RQ is RQ and as well as R gamma are limited to the 1. For ZQ is equal to 0, RQ as well as R gamma are limited to 0.5. Foundation settlement. Settlement, total settlement and differential settlement of the foundation and consequently of the structure of the foundation. Source of settlement, elastic compression of the foundation and underlying soil giving rise to what is known as immediate contact, initial or distortion settlement. Plastic compression of the underlying soil giving rise to the consolidation settlement of the fine grained soil, both primary and consolidation. Groundwater lowering, the lowering is basically repeated lowering and raising of the groundwater level in loose granular soils and drainage without adequate filter protection. Vibration due to the pile driving, blasting or oscillating a machinery in the granular soils, seasonal swelling and shrinkage of expansive soil, surface erosion, creep or landslide in the earth slopes, miscellaneous sources such as adjacent excavation, mining or subsidence and underground erosion. The settlement from first two sources alone may be predicted with a fair degree of confidence. The total settlement may be considered to consist of the following contribution: initial settlement or elastic compression, consolidation settlement or primary consolidation, secondary settlement or secondary compression, initial settlement or elastic compression. This is also refers to as distortion settlement or contact settlement and is usually taken to occur immediately on application of the foundation load. Such immediate settlement in case of partially saturated soil is primarily due to the expulsion of the gases and due to the elastic compression and rearrangement of the particles. In case of saturated soil, immediate settlement is considered to be the result of the vertical soil compression. Immediate settlement in the cohesionless soil is standard penetration test, D. Beers-Martens, 1957. This method has been developed for the use of the Dutch cone penetrometer but can be adopted for a standard penetration test. The immediate settlement SI is given by SI is equal to H upon CS into log base E sigma naught plus delta sigma upon sigma naught. S capital H is equal to thickness of the layer getting compressed, sigma naught is equal to effective overburden pressure at the base center of the layer before any excavation or application of the load, delta sigma is equal to vertical stress increment at the center of the layer, and CS is equal to compressibility constant given by CS is equal to 1.5 CR upon sigma naught, CR being the static resistance in kilonewton per meter square and sigma naught being the effective overburden pressure at the point tested. The value of the CR obtained from the Dutch cone penetration test correlation to be recorded. Number of the blows capital N obtained from the standard penetration test according to the May and Nixon 1961. CR ranged from 430 Newton kilonewton per meter square to the 1930 Newton kilonewton per meter square. However, CR is more commonly taken as 400 Newton as proposed by Mayerhoff in 1956. So this is the relationship between the pressure and settlement of 305 mm square plate for different values of N gamma dash and cohesionless and dash in cohesionless soil after Thornburn in 1963. You can see for settlement in pressure is given and you can determine the value of N dash. the use of the chart, the actual number of the blows, capital N, the from the standard penetration test has to be corrected under certain circumstances. Obtain N dash, the corrected value. Thornburn 1963 has given a set of the curve to obtain N dash from N. He also extends the graphical relationship given by Terzaghi and Peck in 1948 between the settlement of the 305 mm square plate under the given pressure and N dash value of the soil immediately beneath it, as shown in a figure, for determining the settlement SF of a square of a foundation on a deep layer of a cohesionless soil by using Terzaghi and Peck's formula, SF is equal to SP 2B upon B plus 0.3 ka whole square. SP is equal to settlement of a 305 mm square plate obtained from chart, and B is equal to width of the foundation in meters. The chart is applicable for the deep layers. Only that is for the layer thickness lot less than 4B from the below the foundation. For rectangular foundation, a safe factor should presumably be used. It is as follows. So, for depending on L by B, you can see the safe factor for flexible and rigid body. Settlement of rectangular foundation of with capital B is equal to settlement of the square foundation of size B into safe factor. Immediate settlement in cohesive soil. The immediate settlement of a flexible foundation according to Terzaghi given in 1943. SI is equal to Q into B, 1 minus mu square upon E is equal to IT. So SI is equal to immediate settlement at the corner of the rectangular flexible foundation of size L into capital B. B is equal to width of the foundation, Q is equal to uniform pressure of the foundation, ES is equal to modulus of elasticity of the soil beneath the foundation, mu is equal to Poisson's ratio of the soil, IF is equal to influence value, which is dependent upon L upon B. Depending on L upon B, you can see the value of IF, influence factor. So SI is for rectangular foundation on the surface of semi-elastic medium is given by SI is equal to Q into B, 1 minus mu square upon ES into IS. Capital B is equal to width of the rectangular size of L into B. Q is equal to uniform intensity of the pressure. ES is equal to modulus of elasticity of the soil beneath the foundation. Mu is equal to Poisson's ratio of the soil. And IS is equal to influence factor, which depends upon the L upon B. Skempton's 1951 gives the following values of IS, L upon B, influence factor for circle. You can see the value. Immediate settle for thin clay layer. For the cases when the thickness of the layer is less than 4B, strain burner, the immediate settlement at the corner of the rectangular foundation of a infinite layer is given by SI is equal to Q into B, 1 minus mu square upon ES into IF. So layer below the, immediately below the foundation, and for the layer immediately below the layer at a certain depth below the foundation, you can see the diagram. So this is the value of IS for different value of H upon B. So for this curve also you can determine the value of IS. Permissible settlement. There are two main ill effect of the differential settlement. The architectural effect, cracking of the plaster for example. The structural effect, redistribution of the moment and shear for example, which may ultimately lead to the failure. Terzaghi and Peck 1948 specify a permissible differential settlement of 20 mm. Between the adjacent column and recommend that the foundation of the sand be designed for a total settlement of 25 mm. Skempton and McDonald 1956 specify the angular rotation or distortion between the adjacent column in a clay should not exceed 1/300, although the total settlement may go up to the 100. Showers in 1957 recommends in his discussion of the paper by Polishin and Poker in 1957 a maximum of the differential settlement of 1/500 for brick building and 1/5000 for foundation of turbo generators. Bozog 1960 summarizes the investigation in Ottawa as follows. Angular rotation 1/180, none, 1/120, slight, 1/90, moderate, and 1/150, severe. IS 1904 in 1965 recommends a permissible total settlement of 65 mm for isolated foundation on a clay, 40 mm for isolated foundation on sand, 65 to 100 mm for rafts on the clay, 40 to 65 mm for rafts on the sand. The permissible differential settlement is 40 mm for foundation on clay and 25 mm for foundation on sand. The angular distortion in the case of large framed structure must not exceed 1/500 normally and 1/1000 if all kinds of minor damages also are accepted to be prevented. Remedial measures against the harmful settlement, removal of the soil strata consistent with the economy, the use of properly designed and constructed pile foundation, provision of lateral restraint against the lateral expulsion of soil mass from underneath the foundation, footing of a foundation, building slowly on a cohesive soil to avoid lateral expansion of the soil mass and to give the time for the pore water to be expelled by the surcharge load, reduction of the contact pressure on the soil more appropriately, proper adjustment between the pressure, shape and size of the foundation in order to attain the uniform settlement underneath the structure, pre-consolidation of a building site long enough for accepted load depending upon the tolerable settlements. Contact pressure is the actual pressure transmitted from the foundation to the soil. A uniformly loaded foundation is not necessary to transmit a uniform contact pressure to the soil. This is possible only if the foundation is perfectly flexible. For clay, pi is equal to 0, this type of contact pressure is shown. For sand, C is equal to 0, and for C5 soil, you can see such type of contact pressures are generated. The test, actually I have discussed plate load test and standard penetration test and plate load test, standard penetration test and cone penetration test, then afterwards I am revising this one. The test essentially consists in loading a rigid plate at a foundation level, increasing the load in arbitrary increment and determining the settlement corresponding to each load after the settlement has nearly ceased each time load increment is applied. The nature of the load applied may be gravity loading or a dead weight on an improvised platform or reaction leading by using a hydraulic jack. The reaction of the jack load is taken by a cross beam or a steel truss anchored suitably at both ends. Test plate are usually square or circular, the size ranging from 300 to 750 mm side or diameter. The minimum thickness recommended is 25 mm for providing sufficient rigidity. Jack loading is superior in terms of accuracy and uniformity of loading settlement of test plate is measured by the means of at least two. So these are the arrangement of plate load test. The test plate should be at least 5 times as wide as a test plate, and at the bottom of the test plate should be correspond to the proposed foundation level. At the center of the pit, a small square is made, the size of being size being that of the test plate and depth being such that. So DP upon BP is equal to DF upon B. So where DP is the diameter of plate and BP is the width of the plate and DF is the depth of foundation and B is the width of foundation. Bigger size plates are preferred in cohesive soil. The test procedure is given in IS 188 1982 revised. The process in brief is as follows. After excavating the pit of the required size and leveling the base, the test plate is seated over the ground. A little sand may be spread below the plate for even support. If the groundwater is encountered, it should be lowered slightly below the base by the means of pumping. A setting pressure of 7 kN per meter square or 70 gram per centimeter square is applied and released before actual loading is commenced. The first increment of the load, say about 1/10 of the anticipated ultimate bearing capacity, is applied. Settlements are recorded with the aid of a dial gauge after 1 minute, 4 minute, 10 minute, 20 minute, 40 minute and 60 minute, and later on an hourly intervals until the rate of settlement is less than 0.02 mm per hour or at least for 24 hours. The test is continued until the load of about 1.5 times anticipated ultimate load is applied. According to another school of thought, a settlement at which the failure occurs or at least 2.5 cm should be reached. From the result of the test, a plot should be made between the pressure and settlement, of which is usually referred to as the load settlement curve, rather loosely. The bearing capacity is determined from this plot, which is dealt with within the next subsection, load settlement curves or pressure settlement curve to be more precise, and are obtained as a result of loading test either in the laboratory or in the field. Audiometer test being an example for in the laboratory and plate bearing test in the field. Curve 1 is a typical for So this is the settlement pressure curve for plate load test. One is typical for dense sand or gravel or stiff clay, which is general shear failure criteria. Curve 2 is typical for loose sand or soft clay, wherein a local shear failure criteria. Curve 3 is for typical of many C5 soil, which is excipient characteristics intermediate between the above two. So determination of the bearing capacity for plate load test. Terzaghi and Peck 1940 has given S upon SP is equal to B into BP plus 0.3, BP upon B plus 0.3 ki power whole square. So S is equal to settlement of the proposed foundation as millimeter, SP is equal to settlement of test space in millimeter, B is equal to site of proposed foundation in meter, and BP is equal to size of the plate in meter. This is applicable for sand. For the relationship is simpler for clays. Since the modulus value ES for clay is reasonably constant, S is equal to SP, 2B upon B plus 0.3 ka whole square, and SP is equal to settlement of a plate of 300 mm square size, and S is equal to settlement of footing off with B. This method of determination of bearing capacity of the footing off with B should be apparent now. The permissible settlement value such as 25 mm should be substituted in the equation that is applicable for equation 50 to 51. And the SP, the settlement of the plate, must be calculated from the load settlement curve. The pressure corresponding to the computed SP is required to be the value of ultimate bearing capacity. Limitation of plate load test. Size plate effects are very important. Consolidation settlement in the cohesive soil, which may take years, cannot be predicted. Result from the plate load test are not recommended to be used for the design of strip footing. The load test result reflects the characteristics of the soil located only within a depth of about twice the width of the plate. Thus, it may be seen that interpretation and use of the plate test results requires great care and judgment on the part of the foundation engineer. Bearing capacity form penetration test. Terzaghi and Peck have prepared charts for allowable bearing pressure based on the standard allowable settlement for footings of known width on sand whose N values are known. So this is SPT N values, and depending on angle of internal friction pi, bearing capacity in another chart, you can see whether it is very dense, it is dense or very dense. So depending upon these SPT N value, bearing capacity in second chart you can see. So above figures do not apply to the gravels or those soil containing a large percentage of gravel. These charts have been prepared on the assumption that water table is at a greater depth than the width of the footing. Below the base of the footing, if the water table is located at the base of the footing, the allowable pressure is taken half that. So from this chart given by Peck, Hansen and Thornburn in 1953 may be used for determination of the allowable bearing pressure for a specific allowable settlement of 25 mm or 40 mm. So in this you can see, depending upon the width of the footing, loose figure 1 is allowable for allowable bearing pressure for settlement of 40 mm settlement, and figure 2 is allowable soil pressure. This is allowable bearing pressure, and that is figure 2 is allowable soil pressure. In y-axis you can see the allowable bearing pressure in kilonewton per meter square for settlement not greater than equal to 40 mm, and for loose, medium, dense and very dense soil. And in figure 2 you can see the allowable bearing pressure kilonewton per meter square on y-axis and width of the footing on x-axis, depending upon the standard penetration and values. You can tabulate the value of allowable bearing pressure. So Tang has proposed the following equation for graphical relationship of Terzaghi and Peck for a settlement of 25 mm. Qna is equal to 34.n minus 3 b plus 2.3 upon 2b r gamma into rd, where Qna is equal to net allowable soil bearing pressure in kilonewton per meter square for a settlement of 25 mm. Capital N is equal to the standard penetration value corrected for overburden pressure and other applicable factors. B is equal to width of footings in meter. R gamma is equal to correction factor for location of the water table. Rd is equal to depth factor is equal to 1 plus df upon b is less than equal to 2, where df is equal to depth of the footing in meter. The modified equation for the tenses Tang is as follows. Qn is equal to 51.54 and minus 3 b plus 0.3 upon 2 b ki power whole square r gamma into rd. Mayer of 1956 has proposed a slightly different equation for settlement of 25 mm, but these yield almost the same result as the tanks. Q and A is equal to 12.25, capital N R gamma R D for B less than is equal to 1.2 meter, Q and A is equal to 8.17 capital N B plus 0.3 upon B R gamma into R D for B is greater than 1.5. A modified equation for Meyerhof is as follows: 18.36 n r gamma into r r d for b is less than is equal to 1 point, and q n is equal to 12.25 capital N b plus 0.3 upon b r gamma into r d for b is greater than 1.2 meter. The IS code has also given the formula for settlement of 40 mm, but it does not consider the depth factor. Depth factor q n is equal to 18.36 and R gamma into RD for B less than is equal to 1.2 meter, and QN is equal to 12.25 and B plus 0.3 upon B R gamma into RD for B is greater than 1.2 meter. QNA is equal to net allowable soil pressure and kilonewton per meter square for a settlement of 25 mm, and is equal to standard penetration value corrected for overburden pressure and other applicable factor. B is equal to width of footings in meter. R gamma is equal to correction factor for location of the water table. RD is equal to depth factor is equal to 1 plus DF upon B less than is equal to 2, and DF is equal to depth of the footing in meter. Tanks in 1969 also given the following equation for bearing capacity of the sands based on the criteria of the shear failure. Q net ultimate for continuous footing is equal to 1 by 6 3N square B into R gamma plus 5 into 100 plus N square DF upon RQ. And Q net ultimate for square or circular footing 1 by 6 2n square b into r gamma 6 into 100 plus n square df plus rq. Capital N is equal to standard penetration value after applying the necessary correction. B is equal to width of continuous footing, side if the square at diameter, if the circular in meter. Df is equal to depth of footing in meter. R gamma and rq is equal to correction factors for the position of the groundwater table defined in equation 52 and 53. So these are the bearing capacity for clays. For pure clay, phi is equal to 0, ultimate is equal to CNC plus gamma DF is equal to 5.7C plus gamma DF, and Q net ultimate is equal to 5.7C for continuous footing. Q net ultimate is equal to 1.3 into 5.7C for square and circular footing, C being the cohesion. Skempton equation are preferred for rectangular footing and pure clay. Correlation of cohesion and consistency of the clay with N value is not reliable. Unconfined compression test is recommended for evaluating cohesion. Over consolidation or pre-compressed clays might not show hair cracks and slickedness. Load tests are recommended in such cases. Settlement of the footing in the clay may be calculated or predicted by the use of Terzaghi one-dimensional consolidation. The bearing capacity of the footing is in consolidation is practically unaffected by the size of foundation. So you can solve such problems. Try to solve these problems. Some gate previous year question paper is also, I have given these problems to you all people. I think I have shared these problems with you all people. There are some gate and engineering services question paper. So friends, here is some reference books that you should follow. C. Venkatramaiah for Geotechnical Engineering, Third and New Age International Publication, Muni Buddho, A.S.R. Rao and Gopal Ranjan, IS 6401 1981 and IS 188 1982. Some good book also by Brajam Das, J. Bowles, and V.N.S. Murthy can be also followed. The only thing which I have forgot to revise in this topic is effect of bearing capacity on layered soil, bearing capacity on rock, bearing capacity on effect of eccentricity on bearing capacity, and shear failure criteria. So try to revise those things. Otherwise, I have discussed the bearing capacity topic on whole and settlement topic on whole. In next discussion, I would like to discuss the vertical stresses theory and consolidation theory. So if you all people might be having any problem to tabulate the value of settlement, immediate settlement and secondary settlement, primary and secondary settlement, once you will revise the concept of vertical stresses and consolidation, I think you might be possible to do the numerical problem related to unit 1 and unit 3 very easily. So after completing revising the vertical stresses portion and consolidation portions, once again I would take the time and revise the chapter of slope stability, in which I would discuss the cases for finite slope and finite slopes, Bishop analysis, Taylor's chart, and Schwedes method, Kullmann method, and certain slope stabilization techniques, certain software, and all those things I will discuss with you all people. Afterwards, if I will get a time, I will discuss some laboratory experiment with you all people, and I am sharing all these things on Moodle. Keep in touch to me if you are feeling any problem regarding subjects. Always feel free to ask me. Keep solving numerical problems, keep solving assignment which I am giving on weekly basis, keep solving gate examination question papers. Thank you friends, thank you students for listening to me. Thank you once again.